welcome to Chandrasekhar Kambar. Now I would request our senior professor Tripurari Sharma to greet him with flower and a shawl. Chandrasekhar Kambar is a prominent Indian poet, playwright, folklorist, film director in Kannada language, and the founder, vice chancellor of Kannada University in Hampi. Also president of the Sahitya Academy, country's premier literary institution. He is known for effective adaptation of the North Karnataka dialect of the Kannada languages in his plays and poems. Kambara's plays mainly revolve around folk or mythology, interlinked with contemporary issues, inculcating modern lifestyle with its hard-hitting poems. He has become a pioneer of such literature. His contribution as a playwright is significant, not only to Kannada theatre, but also to the Indian theatre in general, as he achieved a blend of the folk and the modern theatrical forms. Kambara has, to his credit, 25 plays, 11 anthologies of poems, 5 novels, 16 research works, and several scholarly write-ups on folk theatre, literature, and education. Apart from his literary career, Kambara has been associated with the direction of feature films. His Kadu Kudure entered into the Indian panorama and won national award. His film Sangeeta won the Best Feature Film State Award in the year 1981. He has also adapted his play G.K. Masthara Pranaya Prasanga for television. He has been conferred with many prestigious awards, including the Gyanpith Award in 2011 for the year 2010, Sahitya Academy Award and Padma Shri by Government of India, Kabir Samman, Kalidas Samman and Pampa Award. Kambara was nominated as the member of the Karnataka Legislative Council, to which he made significant contributions through his interventions. A very, very warm welcome to you, sir. Now I would request him to continue his session. Okay, thank you.
Really concerned with the about the NSD, and I am proud of NSD because it is one of the best institution, theatre institution in the world. I said world because I have seen many of the world theatre institutions and teaching institutions and propaganda institutions also, but of all the things, I am proud of this NSD. And the way it is going on, doing things, doing productions and doing, you know, spreading theatre all over the country is wonderful, marvelous. So therefore I thought I should talk something fair. I wrote something, of course, wherever I wanted to read about Indian theatre, and I wrote some articles and of them, what I thought, I wanted to say you something, so I came over here, and thank you for giving me the audience. On this occasion, friends, I would like to share a few of my thoughts regarding theatre and playwriting, since my major preoccupation has been theatre and drama. I deem it fit to share amongst you today my recent perceptions in this direction. Certain interesting facts emerged in the process of world history during the last century. For example, the Indian subcontinent gathered nationhood for the very first time in a known history of at least 3,000 years. But this coincided with the weakening of nationalism among advanced Western countries. Two tragic world wars had demonstrated the horrible implications of nationalism. Thomas Hardy, Jean-Paul Sartre, Camus and others reflected this spirit in their works. Back in India, our writer responded no doubt to his Western counterpart, but he also had to realize that he lived in a world which was evolving into nationhood from being a colony, while in the West, nationhood was becoming unfashionable. The West of the 1950s and 60s produced hippie culture, the Beatles, Woodstock, Timothy Leary, and experiment with drugs. All this was an important aspect of ferment of rejection and a loss of faith in past social, religious, and political institutions. India had no parallel in terms of seriousness. It only had pale snob imitation in the big cities. The Indian playwright, however, continued to write, placing himself in a mold which was not fully a result of influences which could be called totally Indian. A question arises here. Did he find himself in a context of conceptual hypocrisy? Upheavals of terrible proportions in the society had taken place in both Europe and in Indian subcontinent. The great wars killed millions in Germany and Russia. The post-partition migrations killed millions in the Indian subcontinent. The Western writer responded crucially by questioning and rejecting the very value system which shaped him. The post-war youth of the West rejected its prosperity and power and chose to experiment with life and other non-European and older cultures. The Indian writer, on the other hand, did not respond to his tragedy with the kind of power that his Western colleagues did. No radical change took place among the Indian youth. They did no doubt wear jeans and t-shirts while studying IITs. On getting their degrees, they sought employment in the West. Sometimes I think that Indian writers wrote absurd plays, folk plays, or used mythical and fertility themes in the same way as IIT students wore torn jeans while his father paid high donations. No further comment is necessary. The history of modern Indian theatre begins in 1853 by a group of Parsi gentlemen in Bombay for the entertainment of the urban population, first in English and then in Urdu. Since it was professional, it was a popular theatre. However, this popular theatre was not born out of the innermost needs of the people, but was imposed upon them. Having no choice, people gradually got used to it. That, of course, is a different story altogether. The influence of the Farsi theatre was creative in the sense that the emergence of drama in all the languages is a historical development of the Parsi theatre. There was no drama in the medieval period in any of the regional languages. After the long and glorious period of Sanskrit drama, drama survived only in folk form. The folk theatre has even today not lost its vibrant spirit. Nevertheless, drama which appeared in translations of Shakespeare, Kalidasa and Bhasa emerged ultimately as an independent literary form. Practically speaking, there is no difference between dramatic criticism and literary criticism in general. It is true that all great drama survives only as a piece of poetry after the disappearance of the theatre. According to a definition in Sanskrit, drama is visible poetry. We are not quite sure whether they emphasized the word visible or the word poetry. Be it anyway, drama remains for many of our scholars a major genre of literature. But we have yet to learn much from the folk theatre, and also we have to unlearn many things that we have borrowed from the Western theatre. The fashionable literary drama rejects the professional theatre as something unrealistic and highly decorative. But the change was only in the script, which dealt with the contemporary story and contemporary problems. I must say here that neither the professional drama nor the literary drama understood the world of theatre, which is not a copy of the world outside. The Indian classical theatre and folk theatre were conscious of the autonomy of the world of theatre, which has its own language of gestures and music and determined by its own conventions. We are all blind to the possibilities of the theatre because theatre, like language, has become only a medium for us. For the last 50 years, there is an amazing development in our theatre activities. It is difficult to assess and evaluate the achievement in this area. We discovered our classical theatre, and also we have identified several forms of folk theatre. A realistic drama which we borrowed from the West has been losing its significance. I am aware of the fact that the confusion is not yet clear, but we now know that we have to develop a new theatre to satisfy the tastes of our people and convince them that there is no culture without a theatre. As I said earlier, the modern theatre in India begins with the professional theatre, with proscenium, the aesthetic of which is yet to be analyzed. It was a copy of the 19th century Western theatre based on the mimetic theory of Aristotle, which in the context of Indian theatre history was totally new and strange. Even now, modern Indian drama, but for a few exceptions, has accepted this theory with all its paraphernalia of plot, character and dialogue. The professional theatre introduced realism through surreptitious ways in the mythological which were produced then. The spectator was thrilled by the severed head of Jayadratha moving from one wing to the other. The mechanical devices could realize the impossible events on the stage. Realization and visualization are the chief techniques of the modern theatre and cinema, and for that reason they have become popular. In this context, it is necessary to consider seriously the spectacle, which was once considered the least important aspect of the theatre. The theatre has lost its symbolic value because of the emphasis on the spectacle, which, like the literal meaning of language, is communicative and not symbolic. The amateur theatre, which is more sophisticated than the professional theatre and caters to the more cultured and educated audience, also has lost its symbolic value. Under the influence of the Western drama, it depends mainly upon the literary value of the play that it produces. The reason for this is obvious. The amateur theatre has received the Western drama only as a form of literature and also labors under the impression that drama is the supreme form of literature. We have produced in modern times many masterpieces and their literary values is beyond question. But the theatre in which these literary masterpieces are produced does not have any significance. The relation between drama and theatre is the same as word and its meaning. One is not subordinated to the other, and together they have to create a social gesture. We do have many plays which sincerely express social commitment, but the actors are not trained to express their commitment, nor the theatre structure to penetrate through the fourth wall. It was only after the establishment of the National School of Drama, the Indian theatre has been trying to acquire its own identity. Is it possible to create a national theatre through these efforts? Or is it desirable to have a uniform national theatre for the expression of our national aspirations, are questions which we have to tackle with utmost seriousness. It is true that drama is a very important cultural activity, and like language, it is both culture and producer of culture. It is both culture and producer of culture. The classical theatre of Sanskrit created a great culture, which lasted for many centuries, but at the same time, it also came in the way of regional and folk cultures. The same is true of the professional theatre in the wake of this century, which still continues in the form of cinema. But the culture it produces is one of the glamour and illusion. The theatre, on the other hand, has founded, fortunately, not become popular. There are two kinds of popular arts in our country. The popularity of mass culture produced by cinema is totally different from the popularity of our folk culture, folk arts. The popularity of folk arts tries in its humble way to satisfy the innermost need of our people, while the popularity of our mass media creates the need and tries to satisfy it. It is difficult in our country, which has a multilingual culture, to evolve a national theatre on the model of Irish theatre. The Irish theatre movement had a purpose of asserting its national identity, and as a result produced playwrights of the stature, Shing, W. Yeats, etc. The Irish plays based on the Irish legends and myths and also folk tales could express profoundly the Irish identity and Irish destiny. It seems that the collective consciousness of the independent India doesn't feel the urgent need for such expression. Theatre ought to be a medium for the spontaneous expression of the urgent need of the people, then only it will develop and prosper. We have as many plays as we want in several languages of this country, but what we need is a lively theatre. A playwright writes plays as a literary exercise, but theatre belongs to the people. A theatre built by the people can choose its plays. This is what actually happens with the folk theatre. The plays are performed for some religious purpose. The plays need not have a religious or even didactic import. The performance of play could be a religious ritual. What is important is that the performance is a necessary part of the culture of the community. Almost all the forms of folk theatre in our country have this religious background. But the significance of this kind of theatre is self-contained and therefore limited. The ritual of performance does not insist on artistic values. Now, some of our modern playwrights have been borrowing techniques and devices from folk theatre to gain communication. But the modern theatre is still in an experimental stage. It shares with the people's theatre to formulate political discourses. But unlike the plays of the people's theatre, it does not become a substitute of political action. It is attracted by the musicality and impersonation of the folk theatre. Moreover, it is also influential by the modern Western theatre. What would be the future of the Indian theatre is anybody's guess. It is difficult to say how long the influence of the Western theatre is going to last. I believe that National School of Drama has an important role to play in shaping the future of Indian theatre. The school as an organization is doing its best, but it should now do something more. What is important is to have a vision and dreams. The school gives training to the future actors, directors and even playwrights. But along with that, it should now do research in the theories of drama and also the historiography of the theatre. We have rich tradition of the classical theatre and we have almost forgotten the values of this tradition. I am not talking about the revival of Sanskrit drama, which is not desirable. But we have to study this theatre and try to understand the theories of drama and acting. We are already using themes drawn from myths and folk tales. We use history to give a new interpretation. In the same way, we can use old theories and use them in a new context. Researching the theories is one thing and building up a new theatre is another. Building a theatre is a creative act and also a collaborative act. By creative I mean an inventive act. In modern times, many things are available to us, and if we want, we can select any theatre among from among the vast range of theatres, both regional and national, and also international. In the name of modernity, we are doing the same thing. We cannot resist the temptation of selecting from the variety of theatres that are available to us. But we have to invent our own theatre, because the dignity of a civilization is reflected in its theatre. We use theatre for entertainment, to expose and correct the follies of a society, and also for reformation. There are theatres of cruelty and fear, theatre of politics and psychoanalysis, and many others. But what I believe is that the purpose of theatre is far more profound and meaningful. We need a theatre to create an identity as human, to understand the interplay of man and mask, to give a concrete shape to our consciousness. The theatre is a dream world, but full of possibilities. As W. B. Yeats puts it, in dreams begin our responsibilities. In the modern world, we are facing crisis of culture. Art, which is commercialized, has become a commodity and also a matter of luxury. The only two dominant institutions of the modern world are commerce and politics, and even science has become a tool in the hands of these institutions. They have changed the pattern of human relationship. What is more dangerous is the fact that a day may come when the human world will be replaced, which can speak, sing, translate, and even think on our behalf. It seems to me that art is the only hope of our world. Let me confine myself to drama and theatre, and see that the theatre shall not be replaced by anything which is not theatre. What is at the centre of theatre is human being. Once it was God's. With these aspirations and dreams, sorrow and happiness, and even his bondage and freedom. The universe, which was a mystery a few hundred years ago, is being demystified. And what we have is a sense of emptiness. Only art in general and theatre in particular, I believe, has the power to fill this emptiness. Thank you very much.
I'm a learner. I want to congratulate you. The way you have described theater as you feel, it is something new for the new generations. So I congratulate you for the stimulations and the inspirations you have given to us. Thank you, sir.
हेलो सर, मेरा नाम राघवेंद्र है. मैं एनएसटी रेपेट्री में आर्टिस्ट हूँ पिछले 3 साल से. मैं जब आपको सुनने आ रहा था तो मेरे मन में बहुत ये जिज्ञासा थी कि थोड़ा सा जो प्ले राइटिंग है उसके नए चैलेंजेस के बारे में अगर कुछ हम लोगों को बता सकें. प्ले राइटिंग में अब जो नए चैलेंजेस आ रहे हैं, क्योंकि प्ले राइटिंग का एक अपना काफ़ी मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि हम लोग कहीं ठहरे हुए थे, तो अब जो चैलेंज आ रहे हैं उसको साथ कैसे डील करें, आपका क्या व्यू है, क्या नज़रिया है, जानना चाहते हैं. थैंक यू सर.
Goodbye. voices. All right. Okay. Achha, you please tell me once again your question. Please.
क्वेश्चन बहुत फॉर्म नहीं है, मतलब एक जिज्ञासा है कि जो प्ले राइटिंग में नए, मेरी इंग्लिश अच्छी नहीं है तो मैं हिंदी में ही पूछ रहा हूँ. तो प्ले राइटिंग में जो नए चैलेंजेज हैं अब, उसको कैसे आप देखते हो अभी, उसके साथ कैसे, उस सब्जेक्ट के साथ डील करना और बाकी चीज़ें, उसके बारे में अगर थोड़ा सा गाइड कर सकें, थोड़ा सा इशारा कर सकें.
सो आई सी For us Indians, you know, we don't see any difference between storytelling and drama writing and writing a novel, writing a poetry are different activities. They are one alone. The first thing I wrote a ballad about my village. It was about my village. And the second part of the ballad, I wrote a play. And third part I wrote very recently. So first part is, the village was changing, you know, changed in such a way. And British had come with their Lashkari and, you know, all that. And in those days, do you know how our professional theatre was? The music, you know, if it is Western music style, it was Rakshasa's song. And if it is classical language style, if it was in classical singing, it was hero, either Rama or Krishna or something like that. And with that, you know, somehow we used to suggest that, look, these British people are ruling us and we have to protest it. That's why all were, you know, doing it. But the only thing is, police were there to watch it. If police is not there, we used to shout at the British people, and it was an act of, you know, Swatantra. The whole thing, whole audience used to collect money and give it to freedom fighters and etc. etc. But if police were there, the drama used to change its nature. We didn't abuse British people and all that. That way, from the beginning, drama for me is something, some purpose to do things. And you know, in our, when Rabindranath Tagore and when Macaulay came to this country and he did one education system, he brought it. That was the second greatest Kranti in the country. Do you know why? First Kranti is Bhakti movement. In Bhakti moment, you can talk your own God. Whatever you wanted to talk in your own language. Nobody is there to listen to you. You and your God, you can talk to them in your own language. In Kannada, in Hindi, or in Marathi, any language. In the beginning, it was only you have to talk to the God only in Sanskrit. And only when some person has to come on our behalf to talk to him. No. Everybody can talk to God directly. This is Bhakti movement. This is first Kranti. Second Kranti is when Macaulay started schools in our country. Anybody can be educated. All should be educated. When the letters Akshara got, the whole nation was thrilled, you know. And in the beginning, only one person in a per village, there was only one person was educated. Not two, only one in for each village. Now everybody was, and new concepts came from the West.
Swatantrya, freedom, samanate, equality, and democracy. These are the concepts we borrowed from them, and the whole nation was thrilled. And in the leadership of Gandhi, we fought, but theatre had a wonderful thing in those times. Wonderful thing, theatre. But our playwrights were silent when in Pakistan and India migrated, billions of people died, no writer did write anything. No play was produced. Why? Which means they didn't have the urge to write plays and this and that. It should be there. And Western counterpart of mine wrote absurd play, so we also wrote absurd plays. Whatever their problem was, we also had the same problem. What is this? We stopped looking at ourselves and our own problems. But I started taking folk theatre is mine, number one. I will write about my own people and about the problems of my own people. So that is where myself and Panikkar in the south started, and myself and my friend and Banu Kadailal and another friend, Kannailal and Arambam and all these people started writing new theatre, and in a way opposing the Western style. But playwriting was behind, and only two or three playwrights came forward, and now we have playwrights. And in those days, all countries have their American plays, Russian plays, and English plays, etc. We have such wonderful theatres in the country, we don't have. And I published it through NSD, Indian plays. First and two, second volumes. And it is kept all over the world. Please remember, Indian plays. And I started a magazine here, theatre magazine. And it was seen wherever you go there, in other countries, my magazine was there. So this way, so we started writing about ourselves in our own way. And I have to decide whether this theory of this Brecht theory is nothing for us. And when I was in the States, there was one living theater in America, popular. In living theater, and in Brecht's theater, some Brecht theater. And he's the group of actors come into the audience and begin to talk to them about their problems. And I never see any meaning in the Brechtian theater, because this is how our theater started in the country. When this Bharata taught his students, 100 students a play, and the Rakshasas did not see it. They made Galata, and they made job, the magic, and actors forgot their talk, and they were stopped and fell on the ground. So the play didn't go well. So then, Bharata said, there is something wrong, because when the play was running, why these Rakshasas get angry? There is no reason why should they get angry, because the play was insulting them. It was Samudra Mathana. in the Samudra Matra, the Rakshas are inserted and gods are, you know, they get all the 14 jewels. So therefore they were insulted and they spoiled the play. But when they went to Shiva, then Bharata said, there must be some, there is something wrong. So therefore, let us show this play to Shiva. Shiva said, it was only dialogue. It was as if two liars were shouting each other or, you know, arguing. Shiva said, this is not play. This is not drama. He added Tandava Nritya, Parvati added Lasya, Nandini added poor vrittis. Poor vrittis are very important for any play. Poor vrittis. And they said, so if you, this is play, and do it. And so naturally, when Draupadi, Dushyasana snatches the sari of Draupadi, he sings and snatches, and Draupadi also dances, and you know, she cries. This way, it keeps you away. You cannot participate in the action here. It keeps you away. Therefore, this distance is created. Why breath? You need breath then. For creating distance, he said this and that. Here it is. This. You see, if you go there in the street, if you snatches a sari of a girl, she will give you. She will beat you, or somebody will beat you. The same thing is done here. Why do you sit quietly? Dushyasana sneezes, takes her saris, but you are sitting quietly. Why? This is distancing. Because singing is there, dance is there, you think that it is play, not life. It distance. The distance is creating. This distancing element is the essential of Indian drama, Indian theatre. So therefore, so here tremendous jadu is done, magic is done. You see, when you, the Dushyanta Shakuntala are playing the, staging the play, you know that is, Dushyanta is PUC boy, and the Shakuntala is the second year MAO girl. You know this. But when the play is going on, you forget all things, all that. You shed tears. Why? What is the magic? This is Indian theater, Rasanubhava. This is Indian theater. So they say they have something else, you know, catharsis. They say catharsis is the. No. Catharsis is something. Whatever they do, okay. But no, our Indian theatre is marvelously done, you know. Even now, it's a great mystery that why that a girl, a ashrama girl and Dushyanta, though played by college students, and the play is of some other time, it doesn't belong to our time, but we believe it and sit together, we forget our identities. When seeing the play, you forget that I am such and such teacher, I am such a student, and my duties are this and that. You never remember. You forget your identity and sit there. And these people make you forget their own identities. This vyapara is certainly something marvelous. This is rasa theory. I'm proud of it, you know. For the theater, such a great gift is given by the Indian theater. So this we can study, and so we can study, and what is the actor, and what is the purpose of the plays, and what is the purpose of all this migration and what is this shifting. So you go to, you have seen folk theatre. In folk theatre, so when Krishna is coming, look, Krishna is coming, Krishna is coming, he also sings. The chorus sings, the Lord Krishna is coming. And Krishna is also sings, Lord Krishna is coming, Lord Krishna is coming. And after that, when he comes on the stage, Bhagavata asks, Bhagavata, hello somebody, may I know who you are? And he jumps and he says, I am Krishna. Then he never repeats the Bhagavata song. The character comes on you, before you. The character is born before you, before the audience. The character was not there. Each character is born before you and it enacts and ends. You should therefore, our folk theatre, you know, in between two rituals, the in between action is theatre. So such theories they have found out, and instead of this, and we are borrowing so many theories by you. Study it, we will study it. But our theory is our theory, and still life, I feel I'm happy about it. Pardon, madam? Playwriting
is not necessary for theatre. I mean, there is a notion that we are all finding around us that it is not necessary for performance or for theatre. So, in that context, I mean, the challenges before the playwright or before the art of playwriting, how would you sort of respond to that?
I don't know whether what you are saying is, you know, but
I will explain what he is trying to take your attention to. There is one trend of thinking in Indian theatre or worldwide that we don't need playwright. Okay, we don't need text, we don't need written dialogues, so and so forth. So this is one very strong, that was one, now it is slowly, you can say, getting diffused. But yes, there is this kind of stream and thinking of some theatre persons or academicians or scholars. So her quest is that, how do you react as a playwright to this kind of thinking? नाटककार की जरूरत नहीं है ऐसा बोलते हैं लोग हाँ और उसी को ढूंढते रहते हैं यही भी प्रॉब्लम है
इफ आई एम फॉलोइंग यू करेक्टली सो लिसन टू मी यू सी यस्टरडे समबडी वाज आस्किंग मी अबाउट द फेमिनिज्म हाउ डू यू रिएक्ट एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा But I said, when it comes to feminism, the Western playwrights and all that, they first think of sex and gender, next gender, and this something very dirty thing that the gender things are going to do this and that. But I said, But Indian feminism is something different because there is motherhood. Motherhood is accepted here or anywhere. It cannot be exchanged for men and women. It has to be there only. And it is there. And it will be there. But when feminism is doing something, you have to remember this also. This fact also. But you cannot say India. I cannot say it is Indian thing. It is forever. But let us think about it and make aware of it about the people, to the people. So theater is mirror, I tell you. Theater is mirror, and when I will see myself in my theater, it is regular. So if theater becomes mirror, then only it is useful to the society, and we will make use of it. And playwright also. And after all, why should we write plays and novels and poetry? We have to say something, you know. This is the way I think we will have our parts done.
Excuse me, sir. So I want to know about what is theatre politics, and what is the role of theatre politics in theatre? And sir, please suggest me some books about this.
Theatre politics.
On politics, theatre politics.
Is there a theatre politics here?
Sir, ne abhi. Sir, nahi.
But politics.
Main research ke point of view se jana chahta hu.
Politics is one of the subjects. Theatre deals. Why? Because when you know, the Thomas Mann says, our another theatre man, he says the 21st and 20th century man, his luck is divided, decided by politics. His daiva is decided with politics. Now we have accepted democracy, we vote, and even if you don't vote, it is your right not to vote. So therefore, not voting or voting, it is political gesture, political action. Then what your theater does. You know the part of the theater now. Politics is one of the subject of the theater that deals it.
Sir, can you suggest me some book on theater politics?
Sir, मैं अभी आपका विकिपीडिया पे पढ़ रहा था, जैसे आपका 1937 से जन्म हुआ और अभी 81 साल तक की लिविंग की जर्नी में अधिकतर लोग आते हैं, तो यहाँ पे अपनी जर्नी के बारे में थोड़ा सा बताते हैं कि जैसे उसमें पढ़ रहा था कि आप यू आर कमिंग फ्रॉम द वेरी हम्बल बैकग्राउंड एंड नाउ यू आर नाउ इलेक्टेड फॉर एट द प्रेजिडेंट ऑफ साहित्य अकादमी फॉर अनदर 5 years. तो हाउ यू सी योर फ्यूचर एंड हाउ वॉज योर जर्नी और वाट यू थिंक एट दिस एज?
But as a playwright, I have still something to say, because you know how politics is. Politics has surrounded us. And we know how to survive ourselves. And we have to survive, we have to see that our culture also survives. So these very things are there, and I'm still writing plays. I told you the director that I am writing a play on Mehmood Gawan. He was the greatest politician we ever seen in the screen. The greatest politician.
He was the greatest politician, Mehmood Gawan. You know, greatest politician, unimaginable, and most of the histories have told him, and he is a Iranian. He came to India and stayed here, and he became minister in Bidar. And at the end, do you know, Maharashtra Vitthal went to save him, and he gave him his darshan. Where is Mehmood Gawan and where is Vitthal, Meher Vitthal? What is this? Many abhangas there, beautiful abhangas there. And can you imagine this? it happens in this country. And when politics was as clumsy, as bad impressive, like this only. It was he, so such things are, yes, I think I would like, I should write a play. So that we can see at least ourselves, let us see ourselves, what we are doing.
Thank you, sir. Sir, my question is...
Where are you?
Yeah.
You have still question?
Yeah, yes, sir. How poetry is related to theatre and what is the importance of poetry for surviving of theatre?
I told you in the beginning. Yeah. In the beginning itself I told you, between my poetry and my plays and my novels, there is no difference. I don't see any difference. Understand? Therefore, when I say I want to say something very intimate and something very strange, he will sing a song. And when my character ever wants to talk, he will sing, song as passage. Anything, you know, any utterances. Our Indian, the first genre, main genre of Indian literature is narration, not drama. We are greatest storytellers in the world. So therefore, in such a way, we created 9 lakh stories, folk tales. Out of them, 2 lakhs are remaining, okay. Anyway, but we are narrators. First was born ballad or epic, not drama. From epic, we take vastus and make plays and etc., etc. But even our plays are done, they are stories. In the beginning, it is Nandi. In the end, it is Bharatavakya. Between Nandi and Bharatavakya, there are two rituals. We invite God, we send off God at the end. In between action, he dances here, whatever he does here, he is the play for us, drama for us. This is the structure of storytelling. The epic also the same thing. So we are storytellers. There is one narration. That is the only genre of Indian literature. No drama, no poetry, everything is included in it. That's all.
I think you got your answer, hopefully. And if Dr. Chandrasekhar Kambar is around, there could be so many questions, queries. I think it is always a chance, or it is always an enlightenment whenever we meet with such a great playwright and ambassador of actually Indian theatre. The person who is absolutely rooted in folk theatre, person who has lived folk theatre, person who has really took myths from folk theatre and reinterpreted as he wanted in his all plays. So for us, he is an iconic playwright in Indian situation. He is a leading light for so many youngsters, young playwrights, actors, directors, who is really writing last 40 years or more than that. And still he is so fresh, still he is so energetic and with full of, you can say, ambitions. About Mahmood, he just mentioned, we wish he should keep on writing because he has really supplied great plays, a milestone classical plays to Indian in Indian situation and to Indian directors, actors, designers, and the entire academic community as far as Indian theatre is concerned. Sir, it's a pleasure to have you with us here in National School of Drama. National School of Drama is not new for him. He is part and parcel of this school because he was chairman of National School of Drama, and whatever National School of Drama is today, he has really contributed his vision to shape up National School of Drama. So on behalf of National School of Drama faculty, employees, students, artists, and other spectators, listeners also, I thank you from bottom of my heart. Thank you very much.